excitement of NHL tonight. Saturday promised some compelling stories, and we see. Just like we continue to see from the Stanley Cup playoffs, it did not disappoint.
Never disappoints in the Stanley Cup playoffs. You know why? It's the ultimate thrill ride, ultimate roller coaster. Walt Disney couldn't create it. I'm going to tell you, it's a special time of year, and special things continue to happen.
It's amazing that in the first four games of the Washington Capitals Columbus Blue Jackets series, the road team won all four. Three of the four games went OT. I think you know where we're going with this. To the highlights.
Let's do it, Tone.
It might just take
Get
more
involved.
Than 60 minutes. There is the great eight. Alex Ovechkin, he guaranteed the series would come back to Washington 2-2. Yes, it would. Let's take it back to game two. Remember, Keelan Moxley? She wanted a puck. No. Keelan, look at, she's disappointed. Keelan, no. But wait, this will melt your heart. Brett Connolly, we salute you. Keelan, and this is what joy looks like. She's ecstatic. Well, she got the crowd all hyped before game five.
That's awesome.
Fan of the game.
Great
and she
job.
Got a signed stick from Connolly.
Come on. Love that.
Adorable.
Great job, Keelan. Great job, Caps and Brett Connolly as well.
Agreed. The Caps had scored first in every game of the series to this point. Past the midway point, Caps on a power play, but here comes Matt Calvert, shorthanded. Goal.
Nice job by Calvert taking this one, being decisive. Here he comes down the right wing wall. Keep in mind, left shot on his offside. So he sells that pass option, finds a little daylight, CBJ up one.
Nicholas Backstrom answers with an assist to Sir Isaac M. Newton. 1-1.
Yes, exactly, because the physics of this goal
yes.
are very intriguing, Tony.
Gravity.
Still trying to figure them out, but well done nonetheless.
His 1-1. First goal of the series made it 1-1. We go to the second. 3 minutes gone by. Here come the Caps. Evgeny Kuznetsov, 2-1.
Kuzi just cruising. He, too, coming down the off wing as the lefty, just able to force it through the wickets.
Look at this chance. Giveaway at the blue line.
Uh-oh.
TJ Oshie. It's Calvert. Whiffs, then spins and scores. It's a 2-2 tie.
When Calvert's making plays like that, I got to give him his full due. He gets the separation. He doesn't panic. Settles the puck down. How about that for focus and the spinorama? He's not just Calvert. He's Calvert on a goal like that. Give him the French pronunciation.
2-2. Here's Obi trying to break the tie on a power play, but Bobrovsky is there.
Incredible flexibility and strength and range of motion by Sergei Bobrovsky. Doorstop save on Ovi.
Power play chance for the home team. Carlson shoots, and the puck goes in off a tip from TJ Oshie. 3-2 home team.
Carlson wired that. I have no idea how Oshie got his hands on that. He might have to ask Bryce Harper.
2.5 minutes in. A one-goal difference. Jackets, erase that deficit. Oliver, Bjorkstrand off the Ian Cole shot, and we're all even at three.
Ian Cole threads this needle perfectly. Great hand dive by Bjorkstrand.
Look at Pierre-Luc Dubois with a great look in close, but it's Braden Holtby.
Holtby turning back the clock, looking like the great Ole Kolzig. Well, he's the future now and the present. Great job by Holtby.
Cam Atkinson couldn't score, neither could PLD. Back the other way, final seconds in regulation. Lars Eller and Michael Kempe.
Oh, somebody get him a sniffer.
Please, wake up.
Please get a sniffer.
This is what we're living for.
Or a coffee, come on.
We go over
the playoffs.
3 minutes in. Caps threatening. And it's Ovi in the slot. Bobrovsky swallows the save.
I got to give Bobrovsky credit. He didn't push out, but he took away the middle of the net, which is highly effective as well on this one.
Watch this. Game over. John Carlson. What in the world? Bob again, Weeksy.
Bob dialed in. Outstanding read. Patient. Look at that flexibility. Great job by him on the goal line.
Braden Holtby, other end of the rink. He would be challenged, and he was sharp.
He certainly was sharp all game long.
So still in this first overtime period, Orlov, Backstrom, game over, 4-3 Caps.
What a game this was. Sergei Bobrovsky was excellent in spite of the defeat. Another deflection goal, and this is how you got to score goals in the Stanley Cup playoffs. Braden Holtby had a tremendous game as well. What a game. This was a highly entertaining Tone, high tempo, and a lot of dramatic moments on both sides.
What a thriller. Dramatic moments is right. Let's hear from Evgeny Kuznetsov after the game talking about another overtime win in this series.
I mean, that's why we practice all summer, prepare all year, you know, play those games for this type of games. And when it's go overtime, I know it sucks sitting on the bench. It's nervous, but at the same time, that's best part in our life. You know, that's why we play. And same time, when you lose in overtime, it feels so bad. But when you win, you can't imagine how that feels great, especially if you're on the ice.
See what we did wrong. You know, we have to play better, especially third period. We give up so many opportunities every game almost, you know, except the last game. And we have to focus on that thing.
I don't think we play well in the third period. We don't have lots of urgency. But in overtime, I think we play solid. You know, we put puck deep. We manage the puck well, and we get the result.
Came at us harder today, and especially in the third. I mean, they were forechecking better and made it harder for us.
But. Well, Holtz was good. Holtz was, I look at it as a little bit of the hockey gods giving us something back a little bit from our last game at home here. Then we just said, hey, let's get on our toes and let's go for it. That's what we've wanted to do when we got in the playoffs. Go for it. You know, we're going to have to be way better in our game. They were real good in Columbus. We're going to have to be real good in Columbus. They got, you know, they're a very, very good team. They're determined. So are we.
A common thread from those remarks as we see Nicklas Backstrom's place among the all-time greats in Caps history. Most game-winning goals in the playoffs. Wow. That is royalty in that organization's history. But a common thread, we have to be better. In that third period, hard to imagine anybody being better than Braden Holtby. They were outshot 16-1, yet they did not fold. Braden Holtby. How in the world does this guy, after not being the guy at the start of the series, come on as strong as he has?
Well, a lot of it is the body of work. So Braden Holtby, if you look at his career as a playoff goalie in the Stanley Cup playoffs, he's been excellent for the most part. You look at his numbers, he's won a Vezina. He's a Vezina Trophy finalist. He's tied Marty Brodeur for 48 wins to tie an NHL historic record
for
most wins in a season. Those things don't happen easily. So for Braden Holtby, I love the fact that he just continued working. He knew... And he had a feeling, hey, they might need me. Grubauer's been great for us. He's gotten us to this point. But again, as not dissimilar to what we've seen from Corey Schneider, support your teammate, push him forward, and work your tail off on the ice to rediscover your form. Well, hey, take a look at the numbers. These look more Braden Holtby-esque since he's come aboard and retaken the reins for the Washington Capitals in between the pipes.
You mentioned him as a Vezina winner, the Chicoutimi cucumber, George Vezina,
yes.
For whom the award was named.
That's right.
Cool as a cucumber. In the case of Braden Holtby, why is it that this guy is able to maintain his poise and composure? We saw them give up a shorty. It seemed like they were in command. He never seems to be burdened by mistakes that are made. He's able to reset, move on. How?
I go back to what a lot of his teammates have told me over the years, starting when he came in the league. Guy, Weeks, you got to see this guy. You got to see him in the warm-up. He's calm. You got to see him in the locker room. He's calm. Well, then he goes out on the ice, and he's calm, but also highly competitive and hyper-competitive. So it's a part of his makeup. And I've had the chance to sit down with him numerous times over the years. I get that same vibe as well. So you can imagine what the guys in the locker room are getting prior to a big game, in between periods in the locker room, pregame, postgame, and that's just a part of his demeanor. So that goes a long way. You know, everybody has their own kind of cadence and their tempo in terms of the way they're wired. This guy is very cool, very calm under fire, very calm under pressure. And I reference the great Ole Kolzig, who was the best goalie in their franchise. Braden Holtby now certainly en route to becoming over the course of time as well.
And this is an easy transition as long as we're talking about cool and calm. John Tortorella, not always that way, particularly after the last game in this series, talking about laying an egg. He's always good for great sound. Here's his post-game press conference after this thriller.
John, a few of you guys said they thought this was your best game of the series. You feel like you deserved maybe a better fate tonight?
We played well. It doesn't matter what I thought we deserved it, or we lost, so we get ready for our next game. Steering contest.
Yeah, you got Alexander Wennberg back. How did you feel that he helped you guys out? Yeah, you guys won a lot of face-offs and
played good.
Can you just talk about the effort of Matt Calvert, not just tonight, but in the last couple of games, he seemed to have elevated his game to the point where he's really been impactful all the way through.
He's played well.
It seems like there isn't, and it probably turns out this way a lot, there's not a lot of carryover from game to game. You shrugged off last game pretty well. Do you feel like you can shrug this one off pretty, you know, and get ready?
Yeah, we'll be back here for game 7.
John Bobrovsky made some ridiculous saves there in overtime. Did you get the sense as this game played out it was going to take a shot like that to get one past him?
Yeah, I thought both goalies played really well. We had some really good chances in the third, too, in the OT, Jens, and two good goalies. Good game.
Tough game for you guys at home, game four. How do you get your team ready emotionally for this game six back home?
I won't have to say a damn word to him, Porty. No. We'll be back here for game seven. Okay.
Our plan.
That's awesome.
That's amazing.
That's Torts being Torts.
I love it. I love it.
Talking about laying an egg and we weren't good and they were. And then this, we'll be back here for game seven. As a player, how do you feel about your coach going into the room and saying that to the media?
Hey, listen, John Tortorella's had a lot of success, as we all know, in his illustrious coaching career. All-time winningest NHL coach, American-born, that is. Won a Stanley Cup. He's had a lot of experience over the years. Listen, at the end of the day, if I'm a player and having been a player, I want to know that the coach feels the same way we do. I want to know that the coach is ready to go out there and do the thing. That's what I want to know. So as players, everybody could say, well, hey, players, you got to be, hey, yeah, that's fine. But we need the guys behind the benches. We need the staff. We need our trainers. We need everybody to have that vibe. And your coach is your four-star general, five-star general. He's got to go out there and set that tone sometimes. So I don't have a problem with that. I think that that takes the heat off of some of the players. There's less said for some of the players. That was a disappointing loss for them. And I think that John Tortorella wears that and chose to wear that on his shoulders and say, all right, guys, I got this. You guys will have it next game. We'll be ready to roll, and we'll force a game seven. I love it.
You just talked about the heat. We admire what Matt Calvert has done in this series. Remarkable, his level of production. Having said that, who needs to step up specifically and deliver for Columbus at home to force a game seven in D.C.?
I think the biggest thing for Columbus right now is I want to see Panarin continue to be Panarin because he's a game breaker. This guy's a guy that can grab a game by the throat and take it over. And he's been great through the better part of this series. But I want to see him grab a game. I want to see Anderson, who's another big-time player, a little bit derailed by injury this year, but I love what he can be. We've seen a lot from Dubois, who's been excellent this year, but I think Anderson, Panarin, those are guys that can grab a game. They can grab a game, and same can be said with Atkinson. Calvert was that guy here in game five, but they're going to need at least two or three of those guys in game six. Why? We know the Washington Capitals have guys like Oshie, big moment guy. We saw it from Backstrom, big moment play. Ovi's done it his entire career, and Kuznetsov as well. So that's why I'm looking at those guys from the Jackets as we move forward.
Caps have won three straight in this series. We'll see what Game 6 has to offer. We're going to take time out here on NHL Tonight. The Leafs came into Boston for Game 5, just trying to stay alive. The Bees looked like the better team through the first four games of this series. What would happen Saturday night? Come right back.
Hitting in the far corner. Rantanen finds McKinnon. Zigzags towards the net. Feeds Landeskog, who scores. What a play by Nathan McKinnon. Landeskog ties the game. Here come the Avalanche. Two on one. Comfer with Andrighetto. Comfer with a shot. Save. Score. Andrighetto. With a minute 28 remaining, the Avalanche take a 2-1 lead.
We can't wait for Game 6. Pens and Flyers, the Battle of Pennsylvania. That's the matinee in Philly. Preds, Avalanche, that's the later game. Game 6 in that series. The two teams that played for the Cup last spring are trying to take a step out of the first round and advance. The teams they're playing trying to force Game 7. It doesn't get any better. It's time now for the NHL Hat Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise. Week C, Game 6. Pens, Flyers, and Philly. Who wins?
I love the tee up tone. You want me to bring it to the people?
Please.
Okay, so I'm going to do what I can. I see that you're dialed in. I know our men and women in the back are dialed in. I'm going to go with the Pittsburgh Penguins. Ooh. On this one. By a whisker, by a whisker. Because, hey, listen, this Pens team, if they've got their sights set on three-peating, they can't underestimate this Flyers team. Now, this Flyers team is resilient. They're led by their captain in Claude Giroux, but also Sean Couturier has been a beast for them as well all season long. Add Voracek to that mix and some of the young D in Provorov and Gostisbehere. They're going to need Neubert to be as great as he was last game in game five, here going forward in game six.
As we look at the numbers, Pittsburgh has had its way in Philly. So if they do, in fact, win the way you're predicting, it would be a perfect 5-0-0 mark on the road against the Flyers. I want to go back to Neuvirth.
Talk
to
us.
Can he do in Game 6 what he did in Game 5?
No question. Neuvirth has played well in the playoffs before. He's carried the Flyers at different times in Stanley Cup playoffs over the years. So it's not a question of if he has the ability. We know he does. He was exceptional in Game 5, but they need him right from the outset. Can't have a leaky one. Can't have one that's going to make guys questioning anything on the bench. He needs to be a game ready, which he's capable of, right from the puck drop and the first shot.
Sean Couturier, when the Flyers have won in this series, he scored the game-winning goals. Mm-hmm. Both those games. His performance, to borrow a phrase I've heard you use, he put on the cape.
Yes.
This is a guy who we weren't sure if he was going to play. Not only does he play, he's plus two. He scores the game-winner. Can he perform that kind of heroic role again?
They're going to need him to, because he does all the defensive work for Dave Hakstol. He loves the matchup, and when you're going up against two future Hall of Famers, be it Crosby, be it Malkin, maybe you get the assignment and you've got Phil Kessel, whoever it is, you need to be able to shut down. He has that ability, but what I love about Couturier this year, and so too do the people in the city of brotherly love, he can score.
Oh, yeah.
And he does score, and I love your point about putting the cape on. You know why? This is what guys say in the locker room. Anybody can be a hero tonight, fellas. Mm. Anybody can be a hero. Us saying that on the desk.
Goosebumps.
I got goosebumps.
Let's go.
Again.
Let's go.
Roll it.
And when we look forward to Game 6 in the Preds and the Avalanche, Sven Andraghetto, he put on the Superman cape.
Yeah, on the rhinestone cape.
That's right.
Yes. A la Elvis.
Andraghetto.
Go ahead, though.
Who wins Game
Come
6
on.
In that one?
I got the Preds in that one. The Nashville Predators, for the same reasons as we talked about, for the Pens, they can't tempt fate. Why? Jared Bednar's team, this is a team that has a lot of skill led by their top line. This top line is as good as any elite line in the league. Nate McKinnon is also a Hart Trophy candidate. I love what Landeskog and Rantanen are doing for them. And the Hamburglar stole one for them in Game 5.
Gabe Landeskog has not scored yet on Saturday. That's because they haven't played. Otherwise, he would have scored.
Ooh.
The guy scores every single game.
Love what
you're doing. How about, as we look forward to this matchup, from an offensive perspective, we understand the fact that the game's being played in Denver affords Jared Bednar the chance to have last change. How much should that top line play?
They should play a lot, all game. No, obviously Coach Bednar is doing a nice job in how he's been able to guide this team. But I got to tell you one thing. There's no rest. These guys don't need any rest. They're all young players.
That's right.
Get them out there as much, as often, as frequently as possible. Did you like all those adjectives?
Absolutely.
Get them out there. Let them sleep out there. Put tents out there, sleeping bags, get a hyperbaric chamber in between periods. Do whatever you need to give these guys the ice time that they deserve, because they're difference makers. And then the onus will be on the deeper team, naturally, which is the Preds, specifically head coach Peter Laviolette, perhaps to get his elite shutdown pairing of Ekholm and Subban out against them. And who knows who draws that assignment defensively in terms of the forwards. But put the onus on Pete. Let Pete have to mix and match and have him chase the matchups, even though he's got the deeper team, because that top line for the Avs is money.
No question. Third question.
Bring it.
And last, will Andrew Hammond make 40 or more saves in Game 6? What a story he was in that Game 5 win. Can he do what he did to help this team win?
I don't know that they're going to yield 40, so that's why I'm going to say no.
Mm.
But in terms of a performance, I've seen him at his best at his time with the Sens. Credit to him for going down to the American League, rebuilding his game, getting another opportunity, and shining in game of NHL experience. And we know what he did for the Ottawa Senators in years past. This is a glorious opportunity for him to reestablish himself. He was money. And hey, you know, it's nice to see all the support out there on social as well, Tone. That support that he's gotten behind him, guys in the locker room, that's exactly what you need this time of year.
Third string goalie. I've heard you say before that guys want to be number ones.
Yes.
We hear you say it about number twos. For a guy in his position to step up and deliver the way he did, almost like a fairy tale.
No question. And hey, listen, there's times when he became a two who became a one, and he was playing meaningful minutes. He was playing big games. He enamored a lot of the Ottawa Senators, his teammates, and the fans during his run. And now this is an opportunity perhaps to do it again, unfortunately, due to the injury. But sometimes that's how opportunities present themselves. Bernier was great. We know Varlamov had a terrific year as well. When you can tap a guy that's an NHL guy playing at the American League level like Hammond and have him come in and extend a series, now, hey, this is no fool's gold.
Mm.
We're expecting that from the Hamburglar. We're expecting him to give a tasty performance here in Game 6.
And he said he enjoys the pressure. I watched his availability. Those are Kevin's picks for Sunday's NHL Hat Trick Challenge presented by Enterprise. Download the NHL Hat Trick Challenge app or play online at hattrick.nhl.com and play daily during the playoffs for your chance to win the $10,000 grand prize and other prizes. Timeout here on NHL Tonight. For the New Jersey Devils, they hadn't been in the playoffs since 2012. They're dismissed in the first round by a very gifted Tampa Bay Lightning team. What's next for John Hines and New Jersey? That's our focus right after this. Here we go with highlights. Columbus and Washington. Ovi said they'd be back 2-2 in the series. He was right. 2-2 in the series, game five. Game tied at one. In the second, 3 minutes gone by Kuzi, makes it 2-1. Evgeny Kuznetsov.
Kuzi gets just enough of this one, coming down off wing, forces it through Bobbs. We got a game.
That's his fourth goal of the series. Get away at the blue line. TJ Oshie couldn't handle it. Matt Calvert is coming, and he spins the goal in. 2-2.
I can't call him just Calvert. I got to give him the French, Calvert. The spinorama after the initial mishandle. Nicely done by him on that play.
Power play chance. Look at Alex Ovechkin with a good look. But Bobrovsky says no.
Bobrovsky with that trademark flexibility and strength. Nice job diagonally along the goal line there.
3-2 Caps early in the third. And then Ian Cole sends it goalward. Oliver Bjorkstrand tips it 3-3.
Bjorkstrand in front of the net. Great hand-eye coordination on that deflection.
Two overtime. 8 minutes and change to go. Dmitry Orlov. Nick Backstrom, game winner.
Nick Backstrom in the nick of time.
Oh, I see what you did.
In D.C., on the Beltway. That was a matinee, folks. That was a fun game to watch, Stone.
Yes, it was. Caps win and take a 3-2 series lead. B's looking to close it out. Up 3-1 in the series. Austin Matthews. Yeah, baby. Austin Powers. And it's Connor Brown, 1-0.
That a boy, Tone. Smile for me. Let me see if that's authentic. Well done, though, by Connor Brown. Getting to the spot inside of 5 Boston Bruins. Leafs up early.
And the Leafs set the tone. They played from a lead. Up 3-1, power play chance, 8 minutes to go in the second. James Van Riemsdyk stretches the lead to 3, it's 4-1.
One of the outstanding net front players in this league. How about the little loft wedge that he uses? 56 degree maybe, short side. That would spell the end of the night for Tuukka. In would come Khudobin in relief.
Keeping up with your golf team to the 17th. 4-2, 14 minutes to go in the third. B's coming back. Nola Chari, 4-3.
I love the young guys for the Boston Bruins. Why? They're willing to get into the trenches to create opportunities offensively. Pay the price. Yes, absolutely. He's pumped. And so too would be some of the players post-game here, Tone, as the clock expires.
Yes, the time ran out, but the ill will did not. 4-3 the final. They'll play game 6 in Toronto. Devils and Bolts. 8 minutes gone by in the first. Sorelli sets up Sergachev, and that's the first goal of the game.
Like the GTHL grad in Sorelli, he's been a nice fit for John Cooper, but so too has been Sergachev all season long.
Corey Schneider early in the second. It is still a 1-0 score. Schneider had to be ready, and he was. 2 saves.
For a lot of you Bees fans back in Boston that watched him play at Boston College, that's not unusual for you. He's an outstanding goalie, and here's another example of it, Tone. Look at that blocker push as he's going from right to left.
Girardi, Killorn, Kucherov, none could break through until there. 7.5 to go in the third. Kucherov from distance.
Double layered screen on that one, and Kucherov able to find just a touch of daylight. Tone, I talked all year. Palmieri needs to shoot more. That guy shoots missiles from the back end.
And then this, Tyler Johnson for the win. Turned aside, but the Devils lose the game, 3-1.
Well, you know, we have to stay out of the box better than we did tonight, and that's it. It sometimes disrupts the flow of the game, but I think if you look at the penalty kill, those guys play their hearts out. I thought Corey was fantastic. You know, Alain did a great job preparing the guys prior to the game, and the guys executed really well. And although it wasn't what we wanted to do, that those guys kept us right in the game right to the end. Well, I think it was a really good growth for all of our guys. I think if you take the veteran players, they hadn't been here in a while. So I think that some of the additions that we made to our team in the offseason were, and even in season, were a big benefit to our team culture. And I think for our younger players, for our first year guys or second year players, this is a real good development tool for them, because they understand how hard it is to make the playoffs, how much commitment you need, how much dedication you need, how hard it is over 82 games to get yourself to get in. And then when you get in the playoffs, then there's a whole different level. And, you know, I think that you can't replicate it. So for us to work the way that we did for 82 games to get in, and we had a competitive series, that's something we can certainly build on.
John Hines saying Corey was fantastic gets our attention. We can see that The last two seasons, the numbers for the Devils, remarkably different. What a leap forward. Hats off to John Hines and his staff and that club for making such a remarkable jump. They got to the playoffs after missing it 5 years in a row. Coming into the playoffs, it was Keith Kincaid in net. Corey Schneider got his attention, got your attention. Going forward, is Schneider back to being the number one?
Yeah, no question about that. I mean, Corey Schneider's been a number one goalie in the latter stages of his career, having really auditioned, if you will, and just mentored underneath the great Roberto Luongo. And from that point, and same thing for Marty Brodeur, but once he got the net, it's been great for this franchise. There's no question about it. So there's going to be some ebbs and flows, even for the good goalies, the high-end goalies, and not dissimilar. He's had some injury troubles as well that he's had to overcome. But one thing about it, he's continued to be Corey Schneider, the person, and he now regained that Corey Schneider, the goalie, as well. So, yes, he becomes the number one. But I'd be remiss if I didn't mention a couple things here. I love the way Keith Kincaid played.
Mm-hmm.
He was excellent. He helped them get into the playoffs. He gave them a shot. Excellent for him taking his game to the next level. And the common denominator there is their goalie coach, Rolly Melanson.
Mm.
I said it earlier in the year, that was a great hire by Ray Shiro, doing his homework and bringing an elite goalie coach. And that, in my mind, helped get them into the Stanley Cup playoffs this year.
That flew under the radar, and we're glad that you pointed it out. Everybody who watches this sport knows how good Taylor Hall was this year. Hart Trophy candidate, Taylor Hart, as we came to refer to him as the year moved along. The one game they won in this series, he had 3 points. What was your biggest takeaway from watching Taylor? This is his first trip to the postseason as an NHLer. What sticks with you?
A couple things, and I've seen Taylor Hall up close during a lot of his games when he first came in the league. What I like is he played with that same passion.
Mm-hmm.
He played with that same freedom. He was emotionally balanced, and he really relished playing in the Metro New York area, playing for the Devils on the big stage, being a big-time performer. Yeah, he's been an all-star in both conferences, but he relished being one of the best players in the league, being an impact player at impact times. As I said, putting the Superman cape on at times when his team needed it the most. And you look at the discrepancy that he's been able to have in terms of the separation, in terms of points between him and Nico Hischier. It was a season for the ages. And privately, I know that both management and the coaching staff, they challenged him to get over the trade. He did that and then some. I actually feel he might have exceeded their expectations internally. And it's the first time he had a chance to play Stanley Cup playoff hockey since winning consecutive Memorial Cups with the Windsor Spitfires in the OHL. And he was playoff mode all season, and he was playoff mode in the playoffs. I love what Taylor Hall did this year.
And let's let this put to bed forever, that narrative that Taylor Hall isn't a winning hockey player and can't contribute to a winning program. Clearly, he did that this year. We're going to take time out here on NHL Tonight when we return. Some unforgettable images from this Saturday in the Stanley Cup playoffs. It is the best show on earth. Come right back.
From the 2017-18 regular season.
The Bears is going to try to clear it away. Here's a chance right back to the front. Oh, what a save! Antti Raanta! You've got to be kidding me!
2-on-1, and look at that movement. Lateral movement. The glove out of nowhere. That is absolute robbery.
And a good stick there by Steen. And now Doughty for Kopitar. Martinez walked in front. Doughty. And over. I do not believe it. A lunging save.
He dove. It was all or nothing for Jake Allen.
Doughty thinks he's got the wide open net because he does.
Jake Allen getting a standing ovation here.
The point shot by Fowler. Silverberg back here. No! Wow! Save of the game by Bernier. He got the paddle out and kept it from going in.
Boy, oh boy.
There's
oh
your
boy.
Classic hockey moment right there.
Here's the save first. Kessler's got to be going. You got to be kidding. He did everything right.
Pass through Jensen. That's it. Take it away. Vucevic breaks down. Joined by Kreider. Vucevic to Kreider. Oh!
Believe the save he made. He loves New York. He loves playing here, and he just proved again why.
Couturier to the puck. Couturier
finds Sanheim the shot. Glove save.
Fleury. Look at that. No problem, boys. I had it.
Marc-Andre Fleury with 400 wins in his career. The 13th goaltender in NHL history to do it.
Crosby, closely watched by Dumont, just chops the puck away. Schultz there, 26 seconds to go. And then tried toward the net, deflected, hooked in front, and a save by Vasilevskiy at the goal line, and Haglund. Gensel found Haglund. He thought he had a goal, but Vasi denies him.
An arm save by Vasilevskiy. Brilliant.
Kasha goes for the net as Richie has it poked off his stick. Good defensive play by Braden McNabb there to dislodge the puck. And here's Brendan Leipzig in a hurry into the Anaheim zone. He's got Tuck with him. Got it over. What a save by Gibson, who lunges with the left hand.
This is as good as you will see.
Played it ahead. Ricocheted off Brodin. Carried ahead. And here comes Nyquist all along. Save! Still buzzing from the remarkable stretch save made by Devan Dubnyk.
Guides it up the boards. Leon Draisaitl all the way across the rink. Connor McDavid centering pass across. Lepestu robs the loose in front and it stays out. Lucic peels back. 2-1. Stop made. Rebound again. Denied.
I don't know if we've seen better here.
Whoa. Murray.
That'll be at the end of the year. The highlight
double
saves.
Wow. The blade. Then the shaft of his goaltender stick.
That's athleticism personified.
Ilya, all right here?
It doesn't look that way. Every team playing a home game has to have a third goalie available. He's going to come in. This is Scott Foster who's going to have to come into the game.
Get this. Scott Foster is a senior financial accountant by day, but here he lives the dream.
He comes in and makes seven stops in a row to preserve a victory.
Congratulations to Scott Foster. You have a moment you will remember forever.
I didn't think he had it tonight, so we went with Anton, who's been very good for us. And then there's always that part that gets the rest of the team's attention as well.
Summary? probably could have stopped more pucks with my eyes closed. That's about it. It's on me, but, you know, moving on to the next one. Trying to finish off in Toronto.
Kept just saying to ourselves, up a goal in the third period on the road. I mean, you know, if you'd write that up in the beginning of the game, we'd take it 10 times out of 10. So we just have to stay calm. Freddie was our backbone, you know, did a great job winning some faceoffs, winning some battles down the stretch, and was able to get the job done.
There was a guy from Boston who once said, victory has 1,000 fathers and defeat is an orphan. How about Tuukka Rask there owning up to it? You loved it when you heard it. Yeah. Why?
I love it because it's such a heavily scrutinized position. And you get scrutinized naturally by guys in your own team, your own coaching staff, your own fans, your own family, your own friends, your own self.
Mm.
And it starts internally, your internal dialogue as a goalie, what you're saying to yourself. And it's nice sometimes to be very candid and just say, hey, listen, tonight I wasn't at my best. That's on me. Guys, I need to be better. I'll be better next game. You buy a lot of equity in the locker room. You buy a lot of equity outside of the locker room by doing that. And that's great accountability. I love seeing that.
The two most beautiful words in the English language are game seven. Could we be headed for a game seven? Do the Leafs win game six based on what you saw these two teams with all their pieces back?
Leafs are great at home. They set a franchise record for wins at home. Freddie Anderson, most wins in a season. Those things would lean towards the Toronto Maple Leafs having the advantage on home ice up at the Canada Center. So I'm going to say yes.
Ah, yeah. And then in a game seven, with that kind of pressure, who does it favor? Considering, I've heard you talk about the amount of experience and the tested nature of this Boston Bruins club with their rings and all the accolades, who does it favor?
Pressure's on the Bees. The Bees are the team, let's be honest. And the Bees the pedigree. Marchand, of course, Z, Tuukka. I can go up and down this lineup. They're the squad, but this is a series. I love it.
This series is fascinating. Wow.